twice a week we get like kilos, you know, like the big kilos came right from Pablo himself. You know, I've talked to that man. I have Pablo Escobar. I've actually talked to him. I have conversations with him.
You know, wow. Yeah. Let's hear about that. Yeah. Like whatever you could. Damn.
Yeah.
That's
just
crazy.
So.
Okay. Go ahead.
4/29/1973. I was born in Illinois in a small town, like 300 people. I started doing drugs when I was 9, doing weed and drinking all by 9 years old. Had a very abusive father. You know, I used to get my ass kicked every day by him, for no reason most of the time. But in and out of the joint, in jail. Third of my life's actually been spent in and out of jails, you know, in prisons, you know, for doing stupid shit, DUIs, you know, did 2 bits for DUIs, year and a half each, and then I did 8 years straight for attempted murder, which I don't think I should have, but it wasn't my fault, you know, kind of was, but it wasn't. This guy hit my sister, smacked him upside the back of her head, and I went over and threw a 2 to his head, and he fell. So I turned around, you know, I'm not going to fight somebody like that. I'd rather have a challenge, you know, so I figured 2 to the head, and he fell. It ain't going to be much of a challenge, so I turned around, and he came up, and he side-hooked me. And I blacked out, and PTSD kicked in, and I knocked him down again, and I guess I grabbed a big old log and proceeded on dropping it on his back, and it broke 10 of his vertebrae in his back. He's paralyzed from neck down now because of me, and the cops came, and I came too, I was already handcuffed in the back of a car, you know, all drunk, messed up, and he wound up dying like 4 times on the table. And so I wound up getting 8 years for attempted murder. I feel bad that I did that to him. You know, I wish it never happened. But in behind his back, I tell him I feel so bad about him. In front of him, I don't tell him I was bad about it at all, because he knew. He knew what happens if I see my own blood, you know. And he did it anyway, so it is what it is. But yeah, I was doing started off with just weed at first. Did a lot of weed, lots and lots of weed. And then I used to grow it. You know, 10 years old, growing weed in my backyard. You know,
wow.
My parents owned 150 acres, so I took the back 50. I bought the back 50 from my parents, literally paid them cash for my back lot. And I turned the back 50 into my own bike track. And I used to ride BMX for a while. For 2 years, I rode BMX and the circuit, and on my circuit, racing and stunting and doing all kinds of cool stuff. And then my dad's plant sponsored me doing that. So I did that for about 2.5 years till my nephew burnt my room down and melted my bike. He wouldn't support it again. But then I got into doing acid really bad. You know, after that, I mean, really bad. And I love you too. Yeah, that's my girl.
She said security what?
Security is walking around up here.
Oh, okay. This place has security?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so really, then I got into acid about maybe 13 years old. Started off with just like 1 or 2 hits here and there. Then it got into doing like a half a sheet, you know, and then it was bad. It was real bad. The good stuff too, you know, stuff that make you hallucinate. Jimi Hendrix, you know. Then I got into eye blotter, you know, doing drips into my eyes, you know, probably why I'm half blind right now. But, and then I went to that, and then went from there, and I started doing coke. Coke was a long time. I went like 7 or 8 years, nonstop, every day. You know, my buddy was a dealer, and he was getting like pounds of it right out of Cuba. You know, 85% pure cocaine. And like twice a week, we get like kilos. You know, like the big kilos came right from Pablo himself. You know, I've talked to that man. I have Pablo Escobar. I've actually talked to him. I have conversations with him.
You know, wow. But, yeah. Let's hear about that. Yeah. Like whatever you could. Damn.
Yeah.
That's
just so
crazy.
So when I met this guy, I've known him for a while, but he needed a place because he had kids. He needed a place to serve. And I had a house. You know, that was my first house that I bought. You know, I was like, 14, 15, you know. When I bought my first house, my parents kicked me out when I was young. I graduated from high school at 16, you know. I was very smart, very, very smart, you know, straight A student, Val Victorian. Had scholarships to go to any college in the country by 16 years old, but never went. But Yeah, so my parents kicked me out, and then they signed up for me to get my own house, you know, because I had the money already, you know, from working as a kid. You know, I saved up all my money. You know, by the time I was 14, 15, I had way over $200,000 in the bank. Wow. So I bought my own home, and then this guy, I met him, and he wanted to serve. So, I mean, I told him, yeah, you can serve out of my house. So first year we come around, you know, we started talking, you know, we got into a trust thing, you know, we had to get that relationship. Then he introduced me, not really physically you can introduce me, but over the phone to Pablo. I talked to Pablo maybe once or twice growing, you know, throughout the six, seven years I was on, I only talked to him once or twice. He asked me how I was doing, how things were going, because me and my buddy would literally sell 3-4 kilos a week, you know, and this was like in the late 80s, early 90s, you know, when that shit was just flying on, you know, big old kilos, awesome coke. But I got into it really bad too, you know, he would come in, you know, he'd go home at night, about 10 o'clock he'd go home. And in the morning when he come, every morning he'd come with a big old cup full already bagged up 20s of crack. And as soon as he walked into my door, I got 10 of those. You know, those were mine, free and clear, no money, God. And then after that, it just, like, for the second year, and then I started getting the clientele, lawyers, doctors, judges. You know, that's why I did such a little bit of time, you know, because I had videos of them in my pocket, had them in, like, right in my right pocket, all of them. So... Yeah, but working for Pablo, it was easy. It was just like people make him out to be a bad guy, but I never thought he was. You know, I mean, yeah, he did what he had to do, you know. I mean, take people out for being, you know, snarks or whatever, you know. And he explained some rules to me about, you know, he don't like trouble. Doesn't like trouble at all. So he would send me and my buddy like almost 3 kilos a week. You know, he called us Americanos, you know. Americanos. Yeah, the white Mexicans. I thought it was pretty cool, you know. But I was on that for like 6 years straight, man. And one day I got up, looked myself in the mirror, and decided, no, that's it, man. I'm like, everything was sunk in. I was like 110 pounds.
Sucked up, huh?
Yeah, I looked massive. I looked bad. I looked real, real bad. I didn't know how the hell I was still grabbing onto women, but I mean, I looked really, really bad. So I just quit. Cold turkey right there. Even with them serving in my house, they're still serving in and out of my house. And,
oh, it's
it is on.
It's on right now. Yeah. Okay.
So anyway, he
okay.
So yeah, I quit. I quit cold turkey. Even with them doing it in my house, you know, I still had my bear and I still had my weed and I still had my acid, you know. So I was all right, you know. I had to get my weight back and shit, you know.
Yeah.
So and then let's see, that was my coke addiction. So. Yeah, when I quit, everything kind of went downhill after that, you know. I started quitting. Me and him started arguing a little bit, you know, because I quit. But it was fun. I'll tell you straight up, the 6 years I was doing it was the best years of my life, dude. Yeah. It was nothing but partying, you know. We didn't do nothing. We'd go to the bars. We'd kick it at the bars, you know. Always nice and groomed. Always, you know, paid for my, you know, I had $1,000 worth of clothes, you know. And we'd go to the bar. We'd kick it at the bars, you know. We went to this bar called Center Court, but we all called it Center Snort, you know, because everybody there is snorting coke, you know, or snorted coke.
Where was that at?
Huh? In Illinois.
Illinois, okay.
Yeah. And I've only been down here for 4 years, but I'll tell you how. I've actually been on the streets for going on 12 years now, but by choice. It started off in Florida. I was married, and I went to Florida for rehab. You know, because I still heard four of her family members died within 6 months of each other. And it kind of fucked us both up. You know, for 6 years, we never argued, not even fought, nothing, no disputes, no nothing. Mm-hmm. And then her family members started dying, and I started drinking, you know, because I kind of cared for them more than I did my own family. You know, so I started drinking real heavily. And then, you know, we decided that I need help. You know, I needed help to quit it, you know, because I stopped it for a long time, but then we were right back to it. And so I went to a rehab in my own town first. And 4 days of being in there, she calls the rehab and says her daughter was in a horrific accident that she needed me out for support. I'm like, all right, so I checked myself out. Couldn't find out her daughter wasn't in an accident. She just couldn't be without me. So she went off that night. The same night I got a rehab, she went out with her girls. And as soon as she left, I went and got 2 fists of vodka and had them down before she even got back home. So we got into a big old fight. She threw me out of my own home. I don't know how the hell that happened, but And so I packed up all my shit. I mean, all of it. For I don't know why. I'm drunk, you know. So I just packed up all my shit and moved it over into my sister's attic, which I'm glad I did, you know. Cause and while I was at my sister's, I started calling around, you know, and I found a rehab that was down in Florida. You know, I've never left Illinois, so when I found I could go to this rehab, it was like, hell yeah, Florida, let's go.
Yeah.
So they flew me down there, and then, you know, she wasn't too happy about that. But then after about 30 days, you know, you're not allowed to make any phone calls when you first get in there for the first 30. So I called her and come to find out that she was cheating on me. You know, didn't even wait 30 days before she started cheating on me. I'm like, okay, you couldn't keep your legs closed. Yo, what the hell's the matter with you? You know, you're married to me, you know. Yeah. You know, I bought you a house. I bought her house. I gutted it and I built her her dream house. She never had to work. Always provided, you know, I always had money. And that pretty much I divorced her. Right there from Florida, I went to a paralegal and had the divorce paper sent to her. Said, just sign them. You can have everything. I don't want shit from you. You know, you can have the house, the car. Doesn't matter. You can have all of it. I don't care. So here I am in Florida now in a rehab. And the insurance that I had, it was all hers, you know, because she had health problems. So I put health insurance on her. So I didn't have to pay $300-$400 for a pill. So she canceled it. And as soon as that day she did that, they come to me telling me, oh, we think you're ready to go to a halfway house. You know, this is like 2 days after I'm all messed up. Now I'm depressed. I got reservations in my head already. Mm-hmm. You know, I already want a drink. So they kick me out and they take me to this halfway house. And right across the street from this halfway house was a liquor store. I didn't even make it into the halfway house, the door. I put my bags in front of the door that they told me I was going to stay in, went across the street, bought 2 pints of vodka. One of them was down before I even got up back across the street. Just tipped it up and downed it before I even got across the street. And I wound up homeless. Well, not at that point, I didn't. So I walked, I was in Fort Lauderdale. I walked to the Fort, or to Daytona. It took me 3 days to walk to Daytona. Got to Daytona, I think it was $175,000 in the bank at that point in time. And so I spent $5,000 of it right there on 3 months worth of hotel room, Ralph beachfront, you know, property.
Yeah.
For 3 months, right off the top. You know, you open up my door, you slide open my open door, you take 5 steps, you're on Daytona Beach. And all my money got depleted right there. You know, the partying, I was buying all the liquor, all the coke, all the marijuana. You know, I was the one who was bringing all the people up for the beach up to my place right there. And we just, night after night, you know, partying. So after 3 months was done, I kind of wound up homeless in Florida. And then from Florida, I kind of just kicked it there for about a year and a half. And then, you know, I went knocking on doors to make money, got up enough money, went to Tennessee, stayed in Nashville for a little while, for about 6-7 months. And from there, went to Kentucky, stayed a little while in there. So I've actually seen 13 other states other than this one. This would be the 14th that I saw, just cruising around, just going. But by choice, I stay homeless by choice because cheaper, not having to pay for hotels and shit like that.
Yeah.
So I get a phone call from my buddy that lives down here. You know, my buddy's gay, you know, but I've known him for 30 years, you know. He's never come at me in a gay way, you know, because when I first met him, it was like, I told him, I could be your best friend or your worst enemy. And, I got down here, and I was here for about 4 months, and he came home one night and propositioned me. And I snapped. You know, I thought he broke my heart, you know. He was a really good friend, and he kept coming at me like that. He knew better. You know, so I called him a fuck like 70 fucking times, like within 5 minutes, you know. He got mad and he kicked me out. So I've been here. I was only supposed to be here for like 6 months and then go to the next state.
Yeah.
But I've been here for 4 years now, going on 4 years. Come June, I'll be here for 4 years. And seen a lot of shit down here, man. A lot of things I didn't even know were possible ever, dude. I love this state and I hate this state all at the same time. You know, because there's a lot of cool stuff here that people, you know, like the homeless don't even realize that's here. But I like exploring, so I've looked at a lot of shit in this town, you know. But I hate how evil it is, you know, because I'm very godly now. Never used to be, you know. I've been godly for probably about 30 years now, ever since I had an accident. I was a car accident. But you can feel it, that evil and energy that's in this town is unreal. This is like, I mean, I've got my face slashed. I've been dozens of fights, you know. I think the best thing that's happened to me in this town is at MOSA. You know, I met her, as she said, 4 years ago. And since she didn't really finish the story about how we met, I will.
Okay, okay.
So,
she's a real sweet girl, and I'm glad you guys. Yes, I mean, you seem like a genuine guy, so I just wanted to share my appreciation for both of you guys.
Yeah,
you guys are real cool.
I'm trying to help her, and I mean, she's got a lot of issues, man, a lot. But, you know, I tell her she don't have to do nothing, just stay home, relax, you know, quit stressing. You know, I got us. I know we both do blues, so, I mean, just... I got it. So just chill out, you know, and I'll provide. You know, you just chill out and relax. I know. Well, I met her 4 years ago. She was with this guy, Andrew, at first. And she came out and fed me one day. And I thought that was pretty cool. And then I told her, man, I said, you know, I'm like, I'm stinking and I'm dirty. And she offered me a shower. So I literally went up to her house and showered, which we didn't even realize till about a couple of days ago that I've known her since I've been down here, you know, that she was the girl that took me up to her house.
Wow.
And gave me a shower. But then about 6 months ago, you know, she was in a tunnel that I was hanging out in, and we kicked it off, you know, we started talking, we kicked it off, started dating then, and, well, 3 days into that, you know, she got scared. You know, she didn't know how to deal with a guy that actually treated her like a lady. You know, she's used to all these assholes, like being an asshole to her, you know, but she didn't know how to handle that, so she left, she ran away. And then a couple, 2 months ago, She was walking with my buddy Josh, and she just happened to stop right in front of my camp to smoke. And I walked out, you know, walked out to her, and I didn't act like I even knew her, you know, even though I did. And I told her, I'm like, why don't you guys come inside the camp? You know, I got it all carved out, you know, no wind. You know, it'd be easier that way. And she knows who I was, but she's not leading on to that she knows. So I get her up in there, and I said, why don't you come in first? You get the more comfortable seat. So she came in first, and then my buddy Josh come in and blocked her off. So she couldn't get out the door. And then as soon as she sat down, we got relaxed. I looked at her, and I'm like, oh, how you doing, Mosa? And she's like, oh, you remember me? I'm like, yeah, I remember you. And you tore my heart out. And, you know, I liked you. I liked you a lot, and you just ran. I didn't understand it, you know. And then that's what she told me. She's like, well, I was really scared, you know. She said, I didn't know how to deal with you. She said, I've never had a guy treat me like that. So she... I said, well, I mean, I still care for you a lot. I said, I never stopped. I said, I've never been with another girl since you. And she just kind of jumped into my lap and started kissing my neck and stuff. And that's how we got back together. We've been together for about 2 months now. But this town, I want to get her out of here. I want her out of the state. I want to just take her away. Just get away from all this craziness, you know?
Yeah.
But first, we got to get off these stupid blues, you know? I've slowed down a lot. I was doing 150 of them a day. Now I'm doing like 10. Like 10 a day, maybe some, maybe less now that got hurt, because see, I'll buy 20 and she does 15.
Yeah, you gotta split it. Yeah,
I don't even split it. I give her like 15 of them, because I don't need it like she does, you know. She smokes them back to back. I'll smoke one here and there, you know, just if I start feeling the hurt from it. I wish these people would have told me about the hurt instead of telling me all the good stuff that about these blues. They never told me any of that, you know. I wish I'd have done more studying on it, because I probably wouldn't even have started them if I knew what had happened if you weren't on them. Because they mess you up. I mean, yeah, I have 34 and 5 broken bones in my life from riding BMX. And every one of them bones come out and haunt me when I'm not on them now. And I didn't think I would ever feel the pain from them things again. But yeah, every one of them, every 35 bones, every one of them ache and hurt every time I come off of these things. But I've actually lived pretty much a quiet life, you know. My childhood, other than my dad beating on me, you know, just... It was easy. There were 300 people in the town, you know, it was quiet, you know, a lot of drugs, you know, alcohol, you know, it was basically, you know, I basically had to do everything on my own, though. By 9 years old, I was a man, you know, I had to cook for myself. My mom was never there. She was always at work. Dad just didn't care. So, by 9 years old, I was cooking for myself. I was getting myself up to school, taught myself how to catch, taught myself how to ride a bike. Yeah, my dad, though, he wasn't drunk or anything. He was just naturally mean, you know,
yeah.
Especially to me, because I don't think he liked me, because I came out 3 months premature. So I was, like, really small, and then I had a lot of health problems on top of that. You know, I was only 4'4" and 60 pounds until I was 17, you know, and then I shot up to 6'1" in 6 months. So, But yeah, I think I lived with my, I couldn't even go to my grandparents' house for the first 5 years of my life, because I was allergic to my parents and everything in their house. So I literally stayed with my grandma for my first 5 years, and then she took my water, asshole. Anyway, she so
after, this one?
Yeah. So when I finally moved in with my parents, not even 3 days of being in with my parents, my dad started beating on me. You know, for nothing. I mean, I don't remember anything I really did wrong, you know. I'd get my shit kicked for my sisters doing shit wrong, you know. I got two older brothers and two older sisters, you know, I was a baby, but yeah, I don't remember. I remember coming home one day and my dad calls me over to the table, and he had a switch, he had a wooden spoon, and he had a 2-foot pipe wrench sitting on that table. And he told me to pick one. And I asked him, what did I do wrong? And he said, just pick one. So I picked a pipe wrench. And he asked me, he's like, well, why are you picking a pipe wrench? And I looked him right in his face and said, because fuck you. And he hit me right in the right shoulder blade with it. Ooh. And then I didn't cry out, I didn't scream out, didn't make no noise because he hit me. And he hit me again, same spot. And he sent me to my room because I still didn't cry out. So by that time, I was like 13. I learned how to put myself somewhere else where my dad was beating on me, you know. I could put myself in Hawaii or something while he was beating the hell out of me, you know, so I didn't feel it. You know, but then he kept me home from school for 2.5 months. Kept asking him, I want to go to school. Why won't you let me go to school? He's like, you're going to tell your teacher. Tell him what? He said, yeah, I know you. You're going to tell him, and they're going to take me up out of here. I said, no, I wouldn't do that. I said, I wouldn't do that because how am I going to get my revenge on you if you're gone? That's exactly what I told him. What did you say? I said, that's exactly what I said. I can't get my revenge on you if you're gone. And one day I will get my revenge on you for all these beans you're giving me. You know, for no reason. I said, I hate you. I told my dad, I hate right to his face, I hate you. I hate every bit of you. But I love him too. You know, I love my dad. I mean, he kept the lights on so I could do my homework, you know. So he still provided, but that's about all I loved about the man. That's it. But other than that, I 16 years old, I remember I got my revenge. 16 years old, came home from graduation, just graduated. Valedictorian, top of the class. He didn't even go to it. So I come home, he starts pushing on me. Well, you think you're smarter than me, don't you? Yes, sir, I do. Well, you think you're better than me? Yes, sir, I do. Oh, you got a smart mouth now? Yes, sir, I do. And quit pushing me. And I told him like 13 times, quit pushing me. And finally, you know, he pushed me on my right side, and I kind of went back and came back with a hit. Caught him right in the jaw and dropped him. He fell on the ground. I got on top of him. Just started throwing him on him. You know, and here comes mom, locomotive mom. She hits me and knocks me two rooms across the room, you know, midair. And I get back up and I go walking back towards my dad, and she tells me no. And I said, don't worry, I ain't gonna hit him no more. I stuck my finger around the bridge of his nose and told him, if you ever hit me again, I'd kill him. My dad never hit me again. But that was 1985. My dad died in 2008. My dad never said one word to me. Not one word in that whole period of time from 85 to 2008. Didn't say one word, not no Merry Christmas, Happy Birthday, nothing. I like to think that it was just because I was the only one of his kids that stuck up to him. So he was proud, but he just didn't know how to say it. You know, he could not give compliments. If dad would have gave me a compliment, I probably would have died. You know, had a heart attack or something. Because that wasn't him. But I forgave him. I forgave him for everything he ever did to me. I even put his name on my arm with a, you know, a rest in peace and a cross for him, you know.
Yeah.
Just to forgive him because I didn't want him to keep the power over me. But other than that, my childhood was pretty calm. Being here has been kind of rough, you know, it's a rough kind of neighborhood. I like to tell people I was just a simple country boy when I got here. Now I'm a city slicker with a fucking attitude, you know.
Man.
But that's the way this place made me, you know. Most of the time, I don't even like who I become, you know. I'd rather just go back to my simple country life, but it's not going to happen as long as I'm here, you know. This place, if you go, you become vulnerable, these people smell it. You know, I remember last New Year's, not this one, but the year before, there was like 20 of us, and we were all sitting around, and we were all telling our New Year's resolutions. Well, I got up, and I looked at them, and I said, well, you guys ain't going to like my New Year's resolution. They're like, well, what is it? Well, I said, well, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I said, so my New Year's resolution is, I'm tired of being used. So if I feel like any of you guys are using me or taking my kindness for weakness or anything like that, I'm not even going to hesitate. I'm going to get up and I'm going to punch you in your fucking mouth. And if you ask me why I did it, I'm going to punch you in your mouth again. And they're like, well, that's pretty harsh, don't you think? I'm like, no, not at all. I said, I'm sick of being stole from. I'm sick of being, you know, used. I'm just tired of it. This city just takes people and just changes their life altogether. You know, and plus there's evil. There's so much evil. But, you know, and I can sense it. You know, I'm really godly now. I mean, really, really godly. I wasn't. I used to worship Satan for a long time, you know, most of my childhood. You know, had hair down to my kneecaps, and, you know, we're all black. You know, I had black fingernail, black eyeliner.
Yeah.
You know, and then I got drunk one night, and I put my car into a 100-foot ravine. You know, jumped it. And when they pulled that car out, I dropped down right then and there and prayed, you know, took God in my life right there because I shouldn't be here.
Yeah.
That car, what it looked like when they pulled it out, I definitely should not be here right now. It, you know how people, they exaggerate when they said the engine was in the front seat with them? I'm not exaggerating. The carburetor was right next to my head. The trunk was smashed in. The top was smashed down. All four tires were this way. All the doors were ripped off. It was a four-door car. All four doors were ripped off. There was a log this big around. Went through both axles. And so yeah. And I wasn't wearing a seatbelt. And the only mark I had on me was where the airbag hit me. That was it. I also had $90 worth of Jack and Coke in me too. So my body's just doing all kinds of crazy shit. But yeah, I shouldn't be here. That car accident should have killed me. You know, but here I am. I also saw God that day. He looked me dead in my face and told me it wasn't yet my time, go back. And that's when I woke up to a cop tapping me on the shoulder. Yeah.
Oh,
so I actually saw God himself, you know. Looked just like me. It's like I was looking right in the mirror. But as you know, God created us in his image. So when I saw God, I saw him in my image, you know, so that's how I saw him. And I've been godly ever since, been going around preaching his word. And so I gave you that card, you know, I carry that card all the time, you know.
That was amazing.
I got more at home. I got a whole box full of those. I carry them around. I give them to everybody, you know. And that's how I helped them four girls, you know, just threw some God in their faces, you know, a little bit, you know, give them a little bit of advice.
Yeah.
Told them, you know, I mean, yeah, your life's doing this right now, but I mean, you all got IDs, you got social security cards. Why don't you just go get a job?
Yeah.
I mean, go work at McDonald's or something, you know. They don't do drug tests. I mean, you can still do your drugs and, you know, but I love listening to people.
Yeah.
It's kind of like you do. I love listening to people's stories because, you know, it gives me more knowledge on shit that I don't know. Maybe, you know, they may teach me something, you know, but other than that, I mean, you want to ask me something, you know?
Yeah, so as far as like a typical day, as soon as you wake up, like, well, what's the average day for you?
A typical day? I wake up and the first thing, I go panhandle. Gotta go make that money, you know, start the blues. You know, gotta have that morning blue. I got to, you know. Other than that, you know, the whole day is basically nothing but blues. That's the story of my life right now, is loving mosa and smoking blues.
Yeah.
It's a whole day. That's good, you know. If I'm not out panhandling for money, I'm off going to buy some and going to look for blues, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, that's basically my days, you know. I wish it wasn't, but it is, you know, and we don't got really much time for anything else, you know. Kind of sad to say that, but it's just really ain't. There ain't no time for much of anything.
Yeah.
We hang out with our friends, but if we didn't have blues right there, we wouldn't even be doing that. You know, we'd be off going to find them, making more money. That's why you see how fast we all kind of yell at you, right?
Yeah.
You know, we got $10. Whoa, all right, you know.
Oh, yeah.
That's how my days have been spent for the last. I didn't start blues at first when I first got down here. I'd never seen meth before in my life. I didn't know what the hell it looked like until I got down here. Heroin, never seen heroin before. You know, so, I mean, I've done them all now, you know, I mean. With the meth, it was a funny story how I did that one. I saw this guy, it was February, and he come up asking me for a beer. He didn't have no shirt on. And now it's February, and I'm like, where's your clothes, man? And he's like, cold out here. You ain't got no hoodie, no nothing. And so I gave him a hoodie, and he asked me if I wanted to do some white. So, you know me, I'm a cokehead. He says white, I'm thinking I'm about to go snort some coke or smoke some crack. I'm like, fuck yeah. Let's go, you know, because even though I don't do it, you know, don't do it no more, every once in a while I'll have my splurge, you know, where I'll go do it for a couple of days and leave it alone again. But, yeah, he comes up and asks me if I do some wine, so we went and got some beer, and then he pulls out a bubble. And I go, what the fuck is that? Okay, how are we going to smoke crack out of that? You know, okay, let's give it a whirl, you know, I'm going to try it, you know, something new, you know, I didn't know that we could do it like that, but cool. So he loads it up and he hands it to me, and he hands me the torch. And I put the torch on it and kept the torch on it. Now I'm getting yelled at. Hey, what are you doing? And I inhale. I'm like,
yeah.
What the hell? I said, that ain't fucking crack. What the hell is that? He's like, no, man, that's G. G, what the hell is G? He says, meth. Why are you calling it G? Glass, you know? And I'm like, okay. So he said, and then it hit me. Then the effect from it hit me. I'm like, ooh. Yeah, all right. Got any more of that, man? So I got addicted to that, and then about a little bit into that, you know, about 2 years doing that, I finally tried a blue, and oh, I loved it. I loved the effect, you know.
Yeah.
The first time I smoked it, I fucking puked and passed out. I loved it. Had to go get more. Wow. You know, and been addicted to it ever since. Then I started selling it, you know, and then I quit selling it, and now I'm that's pretty much brings me to now.
Yeah.
You know, the, just doing it day by day, you know, struggling a little bit. It's like a job now, though, man. I'm fucking tired of it.
Just gotta maintain it.
I hate this shit. I hate struggling. I hate trying to find, you know. And then it's not as easy as people think just to stop it. You know, I would love just to get up one morning and say, I don't fucking want this no more. Yeah. But it's not gonna happen, you know. Just because I'm telling myself that right now. It's not gonna happen. I know it's not. Because I'm not ready. I'm not ready to quit. When I'm ready, I got strong will. When I tell myself it's enough, I'll be done.
Yeah.
You know, I can do it with coke. I'm 3 years sober off alcohol now.
Wow.
You know, literally 3 years just since I've been down here. So I just quit drinking. I just, one day I woke up and said, fuck it, I don't want this shit no more.
Yeah.
Tired of being headached every freaking morning, and you know. So I haven't drank in 3 years, been clean and sober for 3 years on alcohol. So that's about it, though.
Oh, yeah. Right on. Well, I appreciate your story, man. Do you have a, if any, like, family or friends see this interview, do you want to say anything, or do you got a message for them?
Yeah, I'll give a shout out, I guess, to my family back home in Illinois. Love you guys. You know I haven't talked to you in, like, 3 years, but if you see this, you know, I still do love you. You know, I don't talk to you because, you know, I don't like you. I don't want to be judged. I have a feeling that you would do that, so it's the only reason I haven't called or anything, so. You know, you see this, I mean, I'm all right, I'm good, you know, maybe someday I'll call you somewhere down the line, but yeah, to my kids, I love y'all, you know, I talk to you all the time, so, you know your daddy loves you, so, but, and then all my street family, how y'all doing, you know, hope y'all could stay blessed, God loves you, I love you, that's it.
All right, thank you for your story, country.
You're welcome.
Appreciate you.